Joel and I are so glad that you've joined us today. We believe that today God is going to encourage you and inspire you and cause you to go further than you ever thought possible. It is so important that you put God's word in your heart, and that's exactly what you're doing today.
We are honored to have you, our beautiful online family and listening live on Sirius XM. We believe you're going to leave better than you came, so thanks so much for being a part. This is a new day. I'm calling out the mighty hero. The forces that are for you are greater than any force that's trying to stop you.
And we believe today, God, that you will do what only you can do.
He calls you a barrier breaker, a prized possession. Thanks so much for coming out today. How many of you are ready to worship the Lord this morning? And God's been good to all of us. And every time I come in, I think about, Lord, it's another day that you have made. And we're making that choice to choose to rejoice and be glad. And I think a part of that is that it's sometimes we're waiting for a good feeling to fall on us. But you know what? I believe we can create our own attitude by saying, God, you're in control. You're on the throne. You know, it's what we focus on. So it's what I love about coming to Lakewood. I tell you, I think every time when I walk out of here, I feel faith in the room. I feel victory. You know why? Because you brought God with you, because you're here. I am with children of the Most High God. We're always blessed and honored to have you. I already welcomed our online family, but thanks for being a part and listening live on Sirius XM. We're going to have a great service today. I think about when I was a little boy, I always heard that phrase, when the praises go up, blessings come back down. Well, I think one thought of it is you can't give God something without Him giving you more back in return. Just the way our God is. I mean, we're here to give praise, to honor Him, but I just believe, I know enough about God that you're not going to leave the same way you came in. You're going to go out of here with more joy, more faith, more victory. Let me tell you, it's going to be a blessed resurrection week. As we started off this this Palm Sunday, just thinking about, you know what? The same power that raised Christ from the dead lives in you and me today. And so we can put our shoulders back. We know God's on the throne, that He's got good things in store for each one of us. But you know what? Don't be a spectator, be a participator. You know, it's easy to kind of, you know, just sit back and think, well, you know, I'm kind of worried, though, Joel, and I got this problem over here. But why don't you take that same energy and use it to believe? Use it to sing these songs of praise. God, You are on the throne. You are fighting my battles. You're bigger than what I'm facing. That's what allows God to do great things in your life. But thanks so much for coming out. We love you guys. We're going to have a great service, and we appreciate you being here.
Yes, amen. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. Isn't it good you got up this morning? Aren't you glad you made it to church this morning? Amen. Thank you, Lord. You know, I love to come into this place with all of you because I love to be reminded about who God is and who I am in Christ Jesus, that I'm more than a conqueror, that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, that God is my God on the mountaintops as well as in the valley. You know, the Bible talks, the Apostle Paul talks about this in Scripture. He says, you know, faith comes by hearing and hearing the Word of God. We build our faith when we feed on God's Word, when we get into an atmosphere like this that just boosts our spirit. So I am glad you're here, and I am glad I am here this morning. So we love you. It is going to be a great service. I do want to speak a scripture over you this morning that's found in Philippians 1:6, and it says, be confident in this. He who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion. See, God is a God of completion. God never leaves any of us halfway, but He always finishes what He started. So today, if there's some things in your life that you feel like are incomplete, you got to know that God is working in your behalf, that He's going to turn those things around. He's going to change things in your favor, that He is going to make sure you get where you're supposed to be. Can I tell you that? He's going to make sure you get to where you're supposed to be. You're going to fulfill your calling, every assignment that He's given you. No one is going to steal what you are supposed to have. Amen? Because God is a God of completion. So let's go into this time of praise and worship with that attitude that, God, You are completing everything that I feel like is incomplete. Things that I can't do, God, You can do for me. All I have to do is do what I can do, follow You, abide in You, and You will complete the work in me. Amen. Let's enter into His gates with thanksgiving and praise this morning. Father, we thank You. We thank You for this time of worship together. I thank You, Father, that the faith that is in this room can bring miracles into people's life. Even those who are listening or watching, Father, there is no distance in prayer, and faith can transcend, Father, through every airway. So we speak faith into Your heart right now. We speak rejoicing into Your heart right now. Father, I thank You that You are doing the work that we can't do on our own. We love You. We dedicate this time to You. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen.
One thing I know is true, God, there is none. I've been good to you. Sing a little loud. Come on, let me hear you. A little.
full of glory, and glory still to come. You are the promise on every page, the hope of a Savior, the name above all names. Who can do a miracle like you? Who can make impossible come true? Take a broken heart and make it new. No one but Jesus. Who can make a blind man see the light? Who can raise the dead things back to life? Take a million wrongs and make them right. No one but Jesus. There is no on the throne, God without equal, you reign above them all. Even in trouble, we won't be consumed, for we are standing.
We thank you that you are all powerful, that you are on the throne, that you are in control, that you have each one of us in the palm of your hand. Lord, as we start off this resurrection week, we thank you for the price that you paid. Even on this Palm Sunday, when you came into the city, Lord, that you made that choice to pay the price for our sins and our sicknesses, Lord. And here we stand today, redeemed and forgiven because of what you've done. We say, worthy is the Lamb. We thank you for all that you've done, Lord, for giving your life and, Lord, making a way that we could have not only eternal life, but an abundant life. And Lord, we stand here as people of victory, knowing that we are redeemed and restored, that you have crowned us all with your favor. You put robes of righteousness on us. And Lord, we believe we are who you say we are, blessed and favored, healthy and strong, not average people, but children of the Most High God. Lord, as we start off the week, we just say it publicly that you're our Lord, our God, our Savior. Make us and mold us into who you want us to be. Lord, I thank you. You're going before us even now, making crooked places straight, opening right doors, closing wrong doors, bringing the right people across our path, and Lord, weeding out those that shouldn't be there. Lord, I thank you that we have the mind of Christ. We have a spirit of wisdom and discernment. Lord, you said when we ask for wisdom, you'd freely give it. So Lord, we ask today and we receive it by faith. I thank you, Lord, that we will make decisions that move us toward our God-given destiny, that our spiritual ears and eyes are open, sensitive, and responsive to your voice. Lord, that we can clearly hear what you're saying, that you're giving us the power to obey. And Lord, I thank you, we will not be at the same place next year as we are right now, but we are moving forward, stepping into new levels of our destiny. Father, as we're worshiping you this morning, I thank you that every force that's trying to stop us has been broken in the name of Jesus. Depression, anxiety, sicknesses, addictions, trouble at work, at home, in our finances. Lord, we believe today is a breakthrough day, that something supernatural has happened. Lord, our eyes are upon you. I thank you that you will get us to where we're supposed to be. And Lord, we're going to keep honoring you. And I thank you, Lord, that you'll keep doing what only you can do. Father, I lift up those that are fighting battles in their health. Some couldn't make it. They're watching from hospitals and listening. Lord, you said you sent your word and healed them. So, Lord, I speak healing to your people right now. Healing and wholeness. Lord, like you did for my mother, even doing what medicine cannot do. Lord, we know you have the final say. The number of our days you will fulfill. So, Lord, I thank you right now that healing is flowing into all those that need it. That resurrection power driving out every sickness. Lord, I thank you with long life you'll satisfy us. And Lord, not just physically, but I lift up people that are in tough times. And some have gone through loss. Lord, you said you're close to the brokenhearted. I ask the Father that they'd feel your presence right now, that you would comfort them and let them have that peace that only you can give. Lord, even though it feels like it's the end, let them know that it's a new beginning, that you are a God that turns mourning into dancing. You said weeping endures for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. Lord, you said you have beauty for the ashes. So Lord, I speak fresh vision, fresh anointing, fresh favor, new beginnings, hope rising up into their spirits in Jesus' name. Lord, you've done great things in the past, but we believe the best is still yet to come, that 2024 will be a blessed, productive, healthy, favor-filled, blessed year, that we are victors and never victims in Jesus' name. And if you receive it, can you say amen today? So awesome to have you in the house of the Lord. Honored to have you. Let's take a moment to make our declaration of faith. Are you ready? I am blessed, prosperous, redeemed, forgiven, healthy, whole, talented, creative, confident, secure, disciplined, focused, prepared, qualified, motivated, valuable, free, determined, equipped, empowered, anointed, accepted, and approved. Not average, not mediocre, I am a child of the Most High God. I will become all I was created to be. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I love that every time we say it. Not average, not mediocre. I'm a child of the Most High God. That other statement too. I'm not going to become half of what I was created to be. I like what Victoria quoted. What God started in your life, He's going to finish. And God is not the type that says, all right, man, you're 80%. You did okay. Or you made it to 85. No, let me tell you, God has something great still up in front of you. You haven't seen the fullness of your destiny yet. And can I tell you this? Not only is there something great, but somebody needs what you have. Somebody needs your love. Somebody needs your smile. Somebody needs your encouragement. This world needs your gift. We won't be who we are supposed to be without you shining like you're supposed to shine. And I just believe as we're coming into this resurrection week, that you're going to begin to blossom in a new way. You're going to begin to bloom and see God do new things in your life. I know there is potential in you that you've not yet tapped into. So keep that down in your phrase. Keep that phrase down in your spirit. You're going to become all God's created you to be. The fullness of your destiny. One more thing before we pray. I love that song. It says God can turn, well, the scripture says that God can turn mourning into dancing. God can turn sorrow into joy. God can turn sadness into happiness. Our God is a God that knows how to turn things around. He's a turnaround God. And so I know sometimes in life you have that big obstacle and you think, well, how can I do it? Well, you know what? You don't have to do it on your own. You have to know the God of the turnaround can show up. God can do what we can't do. And I love how Jesus made it so simple. When you believe, all things are possible. He didn't say you got to figure it all out. He says, if you'll just believe, then I'll do what you can't do. See, we're natural and, you know, we think naturally, of course, but God is supernatural. You know, God can do what we can't do. And I just encourage you to take the limits off of God. Because let me tell you, 2024 is not going to be just a get by year. It's going to be a favor filled year. You're going to see God do some new things, some uncommon things. We just speak that blessing over each one of you. And as we go into this Easter week, we just going to keep that down in your spirit. It's a time of resurrection. It's a time where God does supernatural things. And when you believe, I believe you're going to see God show out in your life in new ways, in Jesus' name. Well, let's take a moment to pray. We always love to take this time to agree with you in prayer. So if there's anything you need prayer about here in the building, y'all know how we do it. There'll be a prayer partner, the front, the back of the sections, all over, up top. Somebody's there willing to pray for you. Anyone's welcome to come for prayer during this next song. And rest of you, you're welcome to be seated if you like, but we'll take this moment to pray. And Victoria's out there to pray with you guys online. But thanks for being with us today. Our honor to have you.
We are so glad that you've joined us this morning, and we want to come into agreement with you for what you want God to do in your life. So today I want you to know that when we come into agreement, there is power in agreement. And I just want to take this opportunity to encourage you that God hears your prayers. He sees your heart to put Him in your life and to seek Him for those needs. And it says in 1 Peter 3:12 that the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous and He is attentive to their prayers. See, He is listening to your prayers. He inclines His ears to your prayers. I love what David penned about God in Psalms 116. He says, God has rescued me. It says, I love the Lord because He hears my prayers. He hears my voice as I cry out for mercy. So David, through all his trials, through all the things that he went through, he came to God with the attitude of, God, I believe you hear me. And that's the decision that we have to make, because when we're in a circumstance that seems impossible or is difficult, you know, doubt can creep in and we can think, God, do you hear me? Or we can pray, God, I believe you hear me. Do we pray from a place of God being eager to hear us, or a place of God being reluctant to answer those prayers? Today, I'm reminding you of those scriptures that says God does hear you. He hears your cry for mercy. He hears those prayers and He scoops those prayers up and He works in your behalf. So today, when you pray, Believe that the tide of the battle's turning. Believe that God is listening and acting in your behalf. Would you put your prayer request in the chat if you haven't already? Because when you place your prayer request in the chat, it's part of your prayer. You're saying, God, I'm believing for this. God, can you do that? God, help me be strong. Whatever it is today, nothing is too small or too big for our God to handle today. And He wants to hear from you. He wants to hear from you. The Bible says He is longing to be good to those who are looking for His goodness. And so we're looking for His goodness today. In fact, I just want to give you a few praise reports. Nikki, she purchased her flight to come to Lakewood Church. That was the desire of her heart. And she was believing God for the finances to purchase those tickets, and she did. So we just are excited to see you, Nikki, and are so glad that God opened that door for you to be able to purchase those tickets. Emily had a successful foot surgery and is starting to walk again. I love that, Emily, and I love that God is going to bring a complete recovery. He's going to bring you back to wholeness. So keep that in your heart and in your mind. So as you begin to walk again, know that He is going to complete what He started. So today, if you have a prayer request, like I said, put it in the chats. We already have prayer requests coming in for mental health. Cecilia says, pray for peace in my mind. You know, God is the God of peace. He is Shalom. He is the God of all peace. He is He is the God of peace. I can't get that out right now, guys. Okay, and William, his daughter, we're praying that she wouldn't have panic attacks. Paige, to overcome addictions. You see, there's so many prayer requests for healing, for relationships to be restored. We have Barbara to reconcile her relationship with her brother. And you know what? That's what we're believing God will do in your life. He will break down those dividing walls that are between you and your brother. So there's so many prayer requests that are already coming in. Debbie, she's believes for healing from Parkinson's disease. It almost is something that she's got to stand firm in, Debbie, and we're going to stand firm with you because the enemy cannot have your body. He cannot. You will live out your days in divine health. You will overcome in Jesus' name. So whatever it is that you want to pray about today, lift it up to the Lord. You can see we have a vast variety of prayer requests, and God hears them all. He's a big God. He created the heavens and the earth. He flung the stars into the sky, and they stayed there. So I can tell you that He is hearing your prayers today. So let's just pray in agreement. God knows your heart, and He hears your prayers. Father, I thank You for everyone at the sound of my voice. God, You know their very need before they ask. You said that You know our down sitting and our uprising. You even know our thoughts from afar. But God, we choose to not just think what we need, but to ask You boldly for what we need today. And I just pray for healing in people's bodies. I pray, Father God, that You'd restore their mental health. That, Father, You would restore lost and broken relationships. God, You are the mender of broken dreams. So we come to You today and lay these requests before You, knowing that You hear us and that You will answer us. You are a good God, a wonderful Heavenly Father, and we call You King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We call You the healer, the peace in us. You spoke to storms and You said, peace be still. If there's storms or situations in people's life that they need that peace, those things need to calm down, I thank You will speak to those areas of their life and that You will bring peace to them. Father, healing is the children's bread. So we partake of what You've already bought for us, the healing of the Lord Jesus Christ. We quote that scripture, by the stripes of Jesus, we are healed. You are healed in Jesus' name from any kind of sickness, any kind of disease, anything that would try to attach itself to you. You are healed in Jesus' name. And I'm not going to break my agreement with you. In Jesus' name, we love you.
Always be loved. Holy, holy, holy. awesome God, don't we? On this Sunday, Palm Sunday, we begin the celebration of what historians call Holy Week. It commemorates the last week of the life of Jesus. And you know, as a pastor's daughter growing up in church my whole life, I've heard the phrase Palm Sunday, and yet I never fully understood the significance of the palm branch and why it was called Palm Sunday. Most of us have heard the stories of how the Jewish people waved palm branches and celebrated Jesus as he rode into Jerusalem. But there's an interesting reason why they may have specifically chosen the palm branch. You see, palm leaves have historically been a sign of wealth and fertility and prosperity and abundance. The ancient Egyptians used paintings of the palm branch to adorn their tombs and temples. The Roman Empire used the same simple motif to adorn their clothing and their palaces. The branches and leaves of the palm tree have been global symbols of royalty and power for centuries. The Israelites took on this symbol of the palm leaf. They even minted their own coin currency to defy Rome and the image of Caesar. Is it a wonder that those people chose the palm branch to herald the arrival of the one they thought was to be their new king? These people had been under Roman rule for decades and believed that Jesus was the one who would lead their revolution. He would come in glorious battle and overthrow the Empire of Rome to establish a new government, an earthly kingdom. But Jesus had a better plan. When he was born, it was prophesied that he would establish a kingdom without end. We know now that scripture was referring to the kingdom of heaven, an eternal kingdom. Jesus did not come to rival an earthly ruler or to conquer an earthly king, because he has no rival. He is the King of Kings. Amen. You see, Jesus wasn't distracted by what this world could offer him as king. He kept his eyes on the prize. Jesus wasn't interested in establishing a temporal boundary in a realm of men. He was interested in breaking bondages that had held people captive for decades, for centuries, freeing humanity from a slavery that has ruthlessly held mankind captive. Jesus was focused on setting people free, not from a tyrannical ruler, but from the power of sin and death. His desire for us to walk freely, unencumbered by the chains of this world, was the very thing that propelled him to the cross. I think in this moment, we should give a shout of victory to Jesus for what he's done. Amen. He wasn't interested in an earthly realm, but a heavenly kingdom. Amen? Yes. So today, on Palm Sunday, as we begin this holy week honoring the heroic sacrifice of our Savior in victory, we still see the palm branch as a symbol of his royalty and his power. We can still see it as a symbol of our prosperity and provision. We can, with grateful hearts, shout Hosanna, the one who has come to save. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Amen.
Coming on the clouds with fire. John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 14 says, and the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son of God, full of grace and truth. The glory of God was made manifest in the person of Jesus Christ. And it is this Jesus that humbled himself even to death on the cross, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Now he has a name that is higher. He has a name that is greater. He has a name that holds more power than any other name that is given. The name of Jesus is the highest name. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, church. Let us exalt his name together. Somebody scream the name of Jesus. There's no other name like Jesus. He's the name above all names. Let's sing.
We do serve a great God who's doing great things in our lives. Thanks so much for being a part of Lakewood today. We love you guys. We'll take a moment to worship the Lord with our tithes and our offerings. We appreciate your generosity and your donations. Together we make an impact all over the world. The scripture says that no good thing will God withhold when you walk uprightly. I know that's each one of you. You're walking uprightly and how you honor God and in your giving. I just believe God's not going to withhold the health you need, the wisdom, the finances, the peace, the joy. Get that down in your spirit that you live under the open windows of heaven, not having to strive and do all this and make things happen. No, just rest knowing that God is fighting your battles, knowing that he is not going to withhold what you need. Sometimes we think, well, I need this right now, or I need this door to open. But you know what? When it's supposed to open, it's going to open. God sees your faithfulness. He sees you doing the right thing week after week and day after day. Keep doing it because God is not going to withhold. He has some amazing things in your future. 2024 is going to be a bountiful year in your life.
Good morning, Lakewood. I'm Sarah Moses. The staff at Atherton Elementary have a rich history of diligently working to empower, enrich, and educate their students. Atherton, like over half of the schools in Texas, is a Title I school. This means that finding the resources to support their vision can be a challenge. That is why 8 years ago, Lakewood Church committed to serve alongside Atherton as they launched their annual Girls Empowerment Day. This day focuses on building up the next generation of young female leaders, and we get the privilege of helping tell them who and whose they are. Over the years, Lakewood volunteers have consistently shown up, provided empowering activities, and gave encouraging words, all while believing that God will give these students the desires of their heart and make all their plans succeed, all to his glory.
Good morning. My name is Alinthia Curtis. I'm principal here at the Atherton Elementary School, home of the Girls and Pearls event. And it's a program that Lakewood Church has been assisting us with for the past 9 years, starting with Manners Matter to now Barbie. And they set up an amazing station about affirmations. And it went along with our activities and our academics for our students. So I just want to say again, thank you on behalf of myself, the students, the parents, the community, for everything that you do, Pastor Osteen, the members, for our students here at Atherton. Again, thank you.
Through your giving, children and families have felt the heart of God in their lives. You know, God's desire for us is to know the joy of making people's lives better. The scripture says that every good and perfect gift comes from above. It's not only a gift to the one who receives the blessing, but a blessing to the giver. God's ways are higher than our ways. So as we get into God's ways, we will truly experience all God wants to give us. Thank you so much for your willingness to spread the gift of God's love to others.
We do love you. And I'm going to speak a blessing over our offering today. Lord, thank you for all the generous people putting you first place. And Lord, we believe what you promised, that you're not going to withhold any good thing. The health, the wisdom, the finances, the peace, the joy. Lord, I thank you even today that you're doing new things. We believe you're working behind the scenes. And Lord, I just ask in faith that their gifts and talents will come out to the full, that they're full of wisdom and ideas and creativity, that contracts and opportunities are drawn to them. Lord, that you're blessing them in greater ways so they can be a greater blessing. Lord, I just speak victory and abundance and increase over every person under the sound of my voice for your glory in Jesus' name. God bless you today as you give.
Here are some ways you can give. Scan the QR code using your smartphone. Text GIVE HOPE to 77977. Go online to lakewoodchurch.com/give. Or call us toll-free at 888-567-JOEL. Your giving is changing lives in our city and all over the world.
You do everything on purpose. I can feel your spirit stirring. I've been praying, you've been working, working it all for good. Fan the flame and keep it burning. You're refining. All the way will be worth it, 'cause you're working it all for good.
I love that. He's a do it again God. Come on, let's all stand together. Have you seen him do it in the past? Well, don't you know he'll do it again? The scripture says greater things are in store. Latter days will be better than your former days. I love coming to Lakewood full of a house full of believers, you know. I believe, I said it last week. Let's see, we've been here, I haven't been here this long, but 65 years. But you know what? Lakewood, what's going to happen the next 65 years from generation to generation? Not just for the church, but how about in your family? God's a progressive God. He wants every generation to increase. Well, you know, you may have gone as far as your parents, but God has greater things in store for you. And let's just keep believing. Hey, as I mentioned, as we go into this resurrection week, I just want you to be believing for God's resurrection power in your life. And you know, that resurrection power to me is something uncommon, unusual. I mean, come on, Jesus coming out of the grave, that's not natural. That's our supernatural God. So let's stir our faith up. We're gonna start it off Palm Sunday. We're already starting it off, but Friday night, a Good Friday communion service. My friend, Pastor Phil Muncy, will all be here taking communion, celebrating what Jesus did. Saturday, we got something special for the kids. Monica, come on up. Monica runs our kids' life. Saturday from 1 to 3, our Spring Fest. Thanks so much, Monica.
Well, it's gonna be a party in here this Saturday, 1 to 3 o'clock, March the 30th. This is the place to be. Bring your family. Pastor, this is gonna be a party in here. There's going to be food trucks. There's gonna be carnival rides. There's gonna be bounce houses. There's going to be over 100,000 filled Easter eggs in this place. It's gonna be a blast. It's the place to be. So bring your whole family out. Bring your neighbors. Bring your coworkers. Invite your enemies. Bring everybody out. It's going to be the place to be.
I can't wait that Saturday for all the kids. And like Monica said, bring, you know, you play Little League with ball. You work out with people. They may not, you know, they may not come to a church, but they'll come to a Spring Fest. Tell them we got 100,000 eggs. They're going to show up, y'all. Your kids are going to be so fired up for about 3 months with all those eggs. So, I told them in the early service, we're going to get them full, not of sugar, we're going to get them full of Jesus, so they'll be doing good. So Saturday, then Sunday, we'll have our services. If you happen to come to the early service, we're going to start it at 8:15, and we'll have our great Easter services. And so, again, invite a friend, a neighbor with you. And I tell you often, but you have influence with people that maybe I don't have. But you know what? They'll come. You may have to go pick them up and have them follow you or something like that. But every believer is a minister. You can impact people. And then last thing, if you've never been baptized in water, the Saturday after Easter, it'd be my honor to baptize you, a church-wide baptism. So a lot of great things in store, but we're honored to have you here today. I tell you often, but your new week goes better because you've taken time to honor God. You could have been sleeping late, running errands, hanging out at your house, but you know what? You said, I'm going to the house of the Lord. Don't you know God saw you take the journey? Saw you take the time to get dressed, even tune in wherever you are. So know that God's pleased with you. And just like I said, you're going to have a blessed week. Doesn't mean you may not have challenges, but God's on the throne. He's got a hedge of protection around you. And we just believe, like the scripture says, God's taking you from glory to glory in Jesus' name. If you're visiting, love to meet you after the service. Honored to have you. Hey, when you see yourself on the big screen, can you give our TV audience a great big Lakewood welcome? God bless you. It's great to be with you today. And I hope you stay connected with us during the week through our daily podcast, our YouTube channel, social media, and you can come visit us in person. We'd love to have you be a part of one of our services. I'd like to start with something funny. And I heard about this 5-year-old boy. He wasn't feeling well, so he had to stay home from church with the babysitter while his family attended. It was Palm Sunday when his parents returned home. His mom told how the church passed out palm branches to the congregation and people laid them down on the floor and Jesus came walking down the aisle. The little boy said, wouldn't you know it? The one Sunday I don't go and Jesus shows up. Say it like you mean it. This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. Today I will be taught the word of God. I boldly confess my mind is alert. My heart is receptive. I will never be the same. I'm about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I'll never be the same. Never, never, never. I'll never be the same in Jesus' name. God bless you. If you'd like to open your Bibles to John chapter 21, you're welcome to. John chapter 21. We'll put other scriptures on the screen. Most of you know our service schedule, but I'll just go over it quickly. 2 o'clock today, a whole service, but it's all in Spanish. What an awesome service that is. Monday night, the Bible study. Wednesday night, our junior high and our youth meet. Thursday night, I thought I was gonna get away with it. Thursday night, our college students meet. Awesome young people. Wednesday night, the service is online. And of course, I mentioned Friday night, we'll have that Good Friday communion service. But thanks for coming out today. I want to talk to you today about something's cooking. We all have things that we're waiting on. It's easy to be frustrated. Why is this taking so long? And I thought I'd be married by now. I thought I'd be over this illness. I thought I'd be further in my career. When we don't see anything happening, it's tempting to take matters into our own hands and try to force doors to open, manipulate a situation, live striving and straining. But the scripture says, through faith and patience, we inherit the promises. And it's good to have faith, but without patience, you can miss God's best. One of the most important things I've learned is to trust God's timing. Sometimes the reason it's taking longer is because what God has in store is much better than what we have in mind. We think we're falling behind, and everyone's passing us up, and I should be further along. But God has blessings that will catapult you ahead. Jesus told his disciples, I'm going away to prepare a place for you. God has some prepared blessings for you. Things he's already lined up. Good breaks, the right people, healing. At the appointed time, you'll come into blessings, favor greater than you've ever imagined. Isaiah said, they that wait on the Lord will renew their strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. Waiting on the Lord is waiting in faith. I don't see anything happening, but God, I believe you're working behind the scenes. It's waiting in peace. You could be frustrated over your job, worried about your health. Your attitude is, God, I trust you. I know you're in control. You already have a solution. I'm gonna be still and know that you are God. It's waiting from a place of rest. You could be trying to force things, make that door open, manipulate that coworker, but you step back and let God fight your battles. You trust him to open the doors, to bring the right people, to vindicate you. You do your best and then rest. You know he's already prepared what you need. So you stay in peace, knowing that at the right time, you'll step in to a prepared blessing. John 21, Peter was very discouraged. Jesus had been crucified, and now he and the other disciples were without their leader. They believed Jesus was the Messiah. They gave up their life to follow him. They never dreamed it would turn out this way. They were so disappointed, wondering what they were going to do next. Well, Peter went back to what he had done before he met Jesus, to fishing. He was at the Sea of Galilee, and he and a few disciples got in a boat and fished all night. They didn't catch anything. They were already disappointed. Now on top of that, they were frustrated. They had worked, strained, put out the net again and again. Surely this time we'll catch something. Once again, the net was empty. Early the next morning, they were close to the shore and Jesus was standing on the beach. They couldn't tell who he was. He asked them if they had caught anything. They told him no. He said to throw your nets on the other side of the boat and you'll catch plenty of fish. When they did, they caught so many fish that they couldn't put them all in. At that moment, John recognized Jesus. He said to Peter, it's the Lord. Well, Peter jumped out of the water and swam to the shore. Jesus had a charcoal fire burning and fish grilling on it. He said in verse 12, come and have some breakfast with me. There's a principle here. What they couldn't catch, Jesus was already cooking. what they were so frustrated over, working all night, toiling, straining, no fish, God already had on the grill. This was a prepared blessing, not raw fish, not I'll help you find what you're looking for. No, I'm gonna cook the fish for you. It's gonna be better than you've imagined. Like these disciples, you may have worked hard, and done your best, but you hadn't caught anything. You haven't caught your healing, so to speak. Caught the right person, caught the good break in your business. You fished all night, but your nets are empty. Can I encourage you, what you didn't catch, God is already cooking. He not only knows where all the fish are, but he's grilling your fish. While you're stressed, thinking it's never gonna happen, he's seasoning your fish. While the medical report says you're not gonna get well, he's putting more charcoal on the fire. While thoughts are telling you, you'll never get out of debt, never break that addiction, never see your family restored, hang on a minute, I smell something. I smell fire burning. I smell some fish grilling. Something's cooking. You're about to taste and see that the Lord is good. You're gonna come into a prepared blessing. You've been working, straining, striving, but what you're laboring over, God is already grilling. It may be taking longer than you thought. You don't see anything happening. My encouragement is, let him cook. God knows what he's doing. When the fish are ready, when it's just right, he'll call you. See, God is a master chef. He doesn't use a microwave. He wasn't on the beach microwaving some frozen fish. Come on in, disciples. I've cooked you a cheap version of what you're trying to catch. 12 fish fillets for $1.99. They've been frozen 14 years. I'm gonna microwave it right out of them. No, God doesn't cook like Victoria. I mean, he doesn't use a microwave. I couldn't resist. But I'm not gonna look at her. God doesn't use a microwave. God doesn't cut any corners. He's not gonna give you a microwave blessing, a lesser version, an imitation. That's good enough. No, God uses the real thing. The charcoal, the fire, that takes longer than a microwave. It seems like a delay to us, but if you could see behind the scenes, God's seasoning your blessing. He's flavoring your promise. He's making sure it's the exact right temperature. Don't be in a hurry, let him cook. He's up to something. You haven't met the right person, let him cook. Your health hasn't turned around, let him cook. Your business seems stuck, let him cook. God has not forgotten about you. He sees you doing the right thing, working hard, praying, believing. You're passing the test. You can't see it yet, but something's cooking. What you're believing for has already been caught, cleaned, seasoned. It's on the grill. Remember when we were trying to buy property to build a new sanctuary, twice that property was sold out from under us. I was fishing, doing my best, taking steps of faith. I thought I caught 100 acres. I had a big fish on the line, but twice that fish got away. Like Peter, I caught nothing. I was disappointed. I didn't see how we could grow. All that time I was worried, the compact center was sitting right here waiting for us. God had already caught the fish. He was in the process of cleaning it, moving out the old tenants, lining up the council members to support us. My nets were empty. What I couldn't see was God was already grilling the fish. All I had to do was let him cook, stay in peace, and at the appointed time, he called our name. Joel, come have some breakfast. I've got what you're looking for. It wasn't just a piece of property, but a prepared blessing, a facility already built. You know what this building is? Grilled fish. But there were plenty of times, you know, I couldn't sleep. We're never gonna find a place. I didn't realize God was seasoning the fish. What if it doesn't work out? We're gonna be stuck. God was putting more charcoal on the fire, making sure it was just the right temperature. Now when my nets come up empty and things aren't happening on my timetable, I've learned this principle, let him cook. God's up to something. You don't have to strain, strive, try to manipulate. All that's gonna do is wear you out. Do your best, take steps of faith, but don't try to force things to work out. If it's not the right time, All your effort can't make it happen. It's going to frustrate you. You can't open a door that God has closed. In the same way, when it's the right time, all the forces of darkness cannot stop what God has for you. Peter had fished all night and caught nothing. He was a professional fisherman. They had huge nets they were throwing out. You would have thought they'd caught something, at least a couple fish here and there. But God was making a point. All of our own efforts, striving, straining, toiling, that doesn't bring the blessing. And yes, we can reach a certain level by working hard, and that's good, but what God has for you is much greater than you can accomplish on your own. There will be times that your nets are empty. You're doing the right thing, not catching anything. You haven't caught a good break, caught a promotion, caught a divine connection. That's a test. Are you going to get discouraged, try to make it happen all in your own effort? Or are you going to recognize something's cooking? God is doing something you can't see. He has some fish on the grill. He's already caught what you're believing for. Instead of being frustrated, oh, why is this taking so long? Let him cook. Our attitude should be, God, I trust you. I trust your timing. I trust your ways. I don't have to understand what you're doing. I'm going to stay in faith knowing that my fish are on the grill, knowing that you have prepared blessings in store for me. There's a young woman. There's a young woman in the scripture named Rachel. She and her sister Leah were sisters. She and her sister Leah were married to Jacob, to the same man. When Jacob saw Rachel, it was love at first sight. She was very beautiful. But their father tricked Jacob into marrying Leah first, the oldest daughter. Jacob had to work 7 more years to marry Rachel. She had already been through this long delay, disappointments. Finally, she got married. She always wanted children. That was her dream, but for some reason, she couldn't conceive. Year after year went by, and she was still barren. Her sister Leah was just the opposite. She had one son after another, 4 boys, strong, handsome. Rachel was so upset, she became jealous of Leah. She tried to manipulate things and take matters into her own hands. Leah's son had some mandrakes. That was a plant believed to help with fertility. They would make this potion to aid in conception. Rachel asked her sister Leah for her son's mandrakes, but Leah wouldn't have anything to do with it. There was strife and division because Jacob loved Rachel more than Leah. She said in verse 15, "You've already taken my husband. I'm not going to give you my son's mandrakes." This was like an episode of Love Island. Rachel said, "If you'll give me the mandrakes, I'll let Jacob be with you tonight." Leah wanted the baby so badly, she agreed. That evening, when she saw Jacob coming in from harvesting grain, after a long day of work, she ran out to meet him, said in verse 16, "You have to come with me. I've hired you with my son's mandrakes." That night, Leah conceived and gave birth to a 5th son. She went on to have 2 more children, 7 children in 7 years. The whole time, Rachel was barren. Her nets were empty. She strived, manipulated, deceived. None of that worked. What she couldn't see was God had the fire on. There were fish on the grill. What she was trying to catch, God was already cooking. He had a son in her future. The reason it was taking so long was it was no ordinary child. The scripture says God remembered Rachel. She conceived and gave birth to a son that she named Joseph. Joseph was the one that would save the Israelites during the famine. He was the one that God raised up to become the prime minister of Egypt, to control all the food supply in the most powerful nation of that day, so he could be good to his family and continue on what God started. The principle is, when it's taking longer than it should, it's because God has something bigger, something better. I was trying to catch 100 acres. God gave me a whole building on the main freeway. Rachel was just hoping to have a baby, but she gave birth to a deliverer, to someone we'd be talking about thousands of years later. One thing we can learn from Rachel is you don't have to connive and manipulate, be jealous of people, try to force things to work out. You don't need their mandrakes. You don't need what someone else has. God has your fish already on the grill. It may be taking longer than you thought. It's because God's seasoning it. He's flavoring it, marinating it, removing the bones, getting it exactly like He wants. Yes, it's been a long time, but I smell something. I smell fire burning. I smell charcoal in the air. I smell some fish grilling. Do you hear that? I hear God calling your name. He's saying, you're about to come into a prepared blessing. Doors opening you never dreamed would open. The right person showing up. Healing, restoration. Don't get discouraged because your net was empty. What you didn't catch, what you hoped to catch. You didn't get that promotion. The medical report hasn't changed. Like Rachel, you haven't conceived yet. Can I tell you, something's cooking. The scripture says God remembered Rachel. God has not forgotten you. He has seen every unfair situation, every lonely night, every heartache. That is not how your story ends. There are prepared blessings that you're going to walk into. Now, in the meantime, let Him cook. Psalm 37 says, don't be impatient for the Lord to act. Keep traveling steadily along His path, and in due season, He will honor you with every blessing. If you'll keep traveling steadily, everything that has your name on it is coming in. The spouse, the baby, the healing, the business, the contract, the freedom. When thoughts whisper, you'll never get out of debt. Everyone in your family struggles. No thanks, I can smell the fish. Something's cooking. You'll never meet the right person. Yes, my net was empty, but I know God's already caught him. You've had this sickness a long time. I don't see how you'll ever get well. No, I know a secret. While I'm waiting, God is cooking. The scripture says, healing is the children's bread. Healing is in the oven. Freedom is in the oven. Promotion is in the oven. Don't fight the wait. Let Him cook. Wait knowing that God is working on what you're concerned about. He's already caught what you thought you missed. Trust His timing. If it hasn't happened yet, it wasn't supposed to happen. God has an appointed time to bring the promise to pass. Rachel was barren all those years. If Joseph would have been born earlier, he wouldn't have fulfilled his divine purpose. God is strategic. He does everything for a reason. There's nothing random, haphazard. He knows what you need and when you're going to need it. It's interesting, 2 years before we needed a larger auditorium, the Rockets basketball team tried to move out of this facility, but the city voted no. They didn't approve the construction of a new facility and wouldn't let them out of their lease. If that vote would have passed at that time, we wouldn't have been in position to try to acquire the building. We didn't need it then. But God controls everything. And sometimes He'll delay things, close a door, cause someone to walk away. We may not recognize it then, but it's all serving His plan. You can stay in peace knowing that He's ordering your steps. David said it this way, God, my times are in your hands. He was saying, I'm not going to be frustrated by the delays. I'm not going to be sour when my nets are empty. I'm not going to live discouraged because I'm not further along. I know something's cooking. I know fish are already on the grill, that there are prepared blessings. In effect, he was saying, there are compact centers, God, that you have waiting for me. There are Josephs. There are healing. There is healing, abundance, ideas. There are books, songs, ministries that God has already destined for you. When you know that God's in control, that your times are in His hands, when your nets come up empty, He's already caught what you need, this takes all the pressure off. You don't have to strive and strain. Got to make this door open, convince these people to like me, and work hard to earn their approval. I got to manipulate this situation at work to get the upper hand. That's going to wear you out. That's being a Rachel, conniving, deceiving, jealous. Life's too short to live that way. Come back to a place of peace. You don't have to catch everything. You don't have to make it happen all in your own strength. God has exactly what you need for each season that you're in. Jesus said, "Seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added to you." You keep God first place, and He'll add everything you need. You honor Him, and He'll grill your fish. He'll catch what you can't catch. The psalmist said, "No good thing will He withhold when you walk uprightly." The key is don't seek the blessing, seek the blessor. Keep Him first place, and the blessings will seek you. When Peter recognized it was Jesus on the shore, he immediately jumped into the water and swam to the beach. They were in the middle of gathering a net-breaking load of fish. So many fish, they couldn't pull it all in. But Peter showed by his actions, he was more interested in the Savior than success. He wasn't focused on the blessing, he was focused on the blessor. He knew where the source of all good things come from, our Father in heaven. He left the boat and went to Jesus. I've seen from the time I was a little boy, when you honor God, He will always honor you. The grilled fish is not the goal. The goal is to fulfill your purpose, to end your life hearing, "Well done, good and faithful servant." But Rachel was barren for all those years, and the 7 years, and plus she had to wait another 7 years to get married because her father was dishonest. And all these delays, detours, disappointments, they come to us all. We worked hard, but our nets were empty. Did the right thing, but other people were unfair. Now we've caught nothing. That's not the end of your story. Those are tests. Through faith and patience, you inherit the promises. You have the faith. My question is, do you have the patience? Psalm 106 says, the Israelites did not wait for God's plan to unfold. It's taken longer than they thought. They got discouraged, gave up on their dreams. Don't let that be you. Keep traveling steadily, believing, trusting, knowing that something's cooking. It's taking longer because it's going to be better than you imagine. Ruth chapter 4 says that Rachel is the one from whom the whole nation of Israel descended. Think about it. This barren woman, jealous of her sister, thinking she was at a disadvantage, that God had forgotten about her, when in fact she would be the one that would birth the nation. Her son would be the one who would save the nation. Who knows what God is cooking for you? Who knows what's on that grill right now? Things you couldn't catch. You never thought it would happen. It's been too long. Like Rachel, you're barren in your business, barren in relationships, barren in your health. That barrenness is not the end. Your baby is coming. Your healing is coming. Your breakthrough is coming. Not something ordinary, not something average, but a Joseph. Uncommon, unusual, grilled fish, a prepared blessing that catapults you into your destiny. Back in the 1980s, my father wanted to build a new sanctuary. We needed a larger building, but every time he tried to proceed, he didn't feel good about it. Something would come up and delay it. He'd get his faith back up and announce to the congregation. Then he'd change his mind. This happened again and again. And he saw these other pastors that were much younger than him building these beautiful sanctuaries. Thoughts told him, "You're getting too old. You'll never build again. Just not meant to be." It seemed like it was the truth. Years went by, no building, no plans, nothing had changed. But when it's not the right time, you're not going to feel a peace. There will be an unrest. No matter how hard you try, the door's not going to open. Timing is critical. You can do the right thing at the wrong time and it not work out. And the reason your nets may be empty is not because there aren't any fish, but it's not the right time. The fish are there. Jesus told Peter to throw his nets on the other side of the boat. They caught so many fish that the nets began to break. They couldn't handle it. God not only knows where all the fish are, but He controls the fish. You may have fished all night and caught nothing, but at the right time, the fish will find you. You won't have to go after them. They'll come to you. 1986, Houston was in the worst recession our city had ever seen. There was that big oil bust, and The price of oil dropped so low, there were more bankruptcies and foreclosures than ever. People going out of business left and right. That's when my father felt peace to build. He knew it was the right time. Logically speaking, it was the worst time. But God's ways are not our ways. And sometimes God will let the odds be against you in a greater way on purpose, so when He does it, it will be a bigger miracle. My father announced to the congregation that we were going to build this new 8,000-seat sanctuary. Should have cost $30 million back then, but things were so depressed. The price of steel, concrete, electrical, we built the sanctuary debt-free for $6 million. The reason God had that delay was because He had something better in store. What am I saying? God can see things that we can't see. He knows what's coming, what you're going to need, where you need to be, and when you need to be there. Trust His timing. Don't fight the delays. Let Him cook. He knows what's best for you, and He has some of these prepared blessings in store. You may have been waiting for a long time. You haven't caught anything. Your nets came up empty. Can I encourage you again? Something's cooking. God's already grilling what you couldn't catch. He already has what you need. It's just a matter of time before you hear Him calling your name, opening the door, bringing the healing, the right person, the breakthrough. Now do your part and wait for His plan to unfold. The reason it's taking longer is it's grilled fish. It's better than you've imagined. If you'll do this, I believe and declare you're about to come into a prepared blessing, favor, healing, promotion that catapults you ahead. Like Rachel, your baby is coming. Like Peter, abundance is coming. Like my father, your dream is coming in Jesus' name. And if you receive it, can you say amen? I receive it as well. Let's pray together. If you have 5 minutes, stick with me and we'll just seal it in prayer. Lord, I thank you for what we've heard today. I know it falls on great ground, faithful people here at Lakewood and so many watching and listening. Lord, we're coming back to a place of peace today. We're not going to live frustrated, wondering when it's going to happen. God, we trust your timing. We believe, Lord, that our times are in your hands, that you are ordering our steps. And Lord, I thank you that you already have that fish on the grill for your people. Lord, I thank you even in 2024, they will see some prepared blessings, things that only you could make happen. Our trust is in you, Lord God. We're not going to live worried and upset. We're going out of here with a greater peace and a greater trust that you are in control. Lord, I thank you for protecting your people as they go out and their children as they go out among their business this week in Jesus' name. With our heads bowed in prayer, just a quick question. If your heart stopped beating in minutes, are you at peace with God? Do you know where you'd spend eternity? If not, I would love to pray with you. I'm not here to condemn anybody. I'm here to help you find a new beginning. I know this comes from a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. In just a moment, if you're not at peace with the Lord, or maybe you are a Christian, but you've grown cold toward God, you know you need to rededicate. You need to recommit your life to Christ. If that's you, in just a moment, I'm going to ask you to take a step of faith and stand right where you are, and we'll pray together. I can't think of a better time to get on the road to victory than right now. God is not mad at you. Your sins have already been forgiven. All you have to do is accept the free gift of Christ's salvation. Will you do it today? In your thoughts, the enemy will whisper, do it next week. Do it another time. Listen, the Bible says, today is the day of salvation. Don't put it off. You're not hearing this by accident. Joel, it's embarrassing to stand in front of all the people. I have people at the house. I can't lift my hand. Listen to what Jesus said. If you won't be ashamed of me before people, then I won't be ashamed of you before my Father in heaven. I'm going to give you a great opportunity to show God that you're not ashamed of Him. If you're not at peace with the Lord, or you just need to rededicate your life, You need a fresh new start, a new beginning. If that's you, would you be bold, take that step of faith and stand right where you are, and we'll pray together. Would you do that? Come on, Lakewood. Let's give them a hand as they stand all over the building. Come on, don't put it off. I feel like there ought to be others. Anybody else? Your heart beating fast? Up top? Come on, Lakewood, they're still standing. Anybody else watching, listening? Still time for you. Take a step of faith. Anybody else? Don't go home without peace. Well, God bless you, and please remain standing if you don't mind. Let me tell you how proud we are of you. I know that took courage to stand, and more importantly, I know the angels are rejoicing in the heavens. God's never going to be ashamed of you because you took this step of faith. The scripture says that whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Let me help you to call. Do you mind all praying this after me? Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. Come into my heart. I make you my Lord and Savior. Amen. We'll remain standing one more moment. I want to tell you how much we love you. We're going to be praying for you. I also want to give you a personal invitation and a challenge to come back and be with us on a regular basis. We ask new believers, give us the next year of your life. Make a commitment, just like you go to work, that this is going to be a priority. You're going to be here every Sunday, in person, online, on the radio. I'll make a promise, before that year is over, your life will never be the same for the better. We're going to help you grow and become who God's created you to be. And I know you're busy on Sunday. It's probably a day off. You could be resting, working, running errands, doing a lot of different things. But let me tell you, there is a blessing on your life when you put God first place and you get into a community of faith. I said it earlier, you can never give God something without Him giving you more back in return. So I hope you'll take me up on that. Hey, after the service, there's a room over here called New Beginnings. If you need anything, talk with some people, information, anything you might need. If you got a moment, stop by. I'd love to meet you. If you can't do it, I'm out there any service for the next 40 years. Stop by and see me sometime. I'd love to see you out there. But the moment you stood up, God washed away all your sins, your mistakes, your failures. You are starting with a fresh, clean slate. Write it down in your Bible, March 24, 2024, a new day of victory in your life, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, let's all stand together if you would. Thanks for coming out today. How many of you are going home better off than you were before? Amen. You're going to have a blessed resurrection week. And until we meet again, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord show you His favor and have mercy on you. And may the Lord watch over you and give you His peace. God bless you. We love you very much. See you back real soon.